So if you're watching this video, then chances are you're already thinking about upgrading your hardware. But you might be wondering, is now the right time? So let's start with a simple question. How often should you look to replace your hardware? For SolidWorks professionals, we recommend doing so every 3 to 5 years, so we find this strikes the perfect balance between efficiency gains and the cost of upgrading. To give you an idea of exactly how much of an improvement you could expect to get by upgrading this year, we ran some performance comparisons between new and old hardware. Our old machine, the type you might be upgrading from, was a 4-year-old Precision 3630 desktop, and we compared this to a new Dell Precision 7070 laptop and a new Dell Precision 3660 desktop. The key components of any workstation are the CPU, the graphics card, RAM, and the storage. We tested all of these, and in this video, we'll share with you our test results and recommendations, so you can decide whether or not now is the right time for you to upgrade. Let's start the comparisons by taking a look at CPUs. The CPU, or processor, handles many key operations in SolidWorks. Upgrading your CPU can improve the speed of opening files, modeling parts, and manipulating assemblies. If you look at the specs for a CPU, you'll see there are multiple speeds listed. Generally, we advise looking at the turbo speed, as this gives the best indication of how SolidWorks will typically run. Our 4-year-old desktop features an i7 CPU from Intel's 8th generation, with turbo speeds of up to 4.7 GHz. The laptop we're comparing it against has Intel's i7-HX 12th generation CPU, which has a maximum speed of 4.8 GHz. Looking at these stats, it may seem that these two processors are fairly evenly matched, but let's wait and see what the test results say. To compare regular SolidWorks performance, we tested some everyday tasks, rebuilding a complex part and opening a large assembly. This part isn't the most complicated, but it does have some relatively detailed patterns, and it was modeled in a way to ensure that the CPU will need to calculate features for an extended period. Our new Precision 7000 series laptop took just 28 seconds to open it. The 4-year-old 3630 desktop, however, took 48 seconds. And the new desktop, the 3660, took 25 seconds, showing that there's only a relatively small difference between laptop and desktop for short tasks like this. Next, we tested the assembly open times, starting by opening this 6000 component Nemo submarine assembly. This took 60 seconds to open on the new laptop, and 1 minute and 40 seconds on the older desktop. The new desktop was faster still, opening 10 seconds quicker than the laptop. It's worth mentioning that all of these tests and all the results and times were from SolidWorks 2023, which has seriously improved the opening times of large assemblies. When we opened the same dataset using SolidWorks 2022 on the new desktop machine, it took 75 seconds to open, which was 1.5 times longer than it did in SolidWorks 2023. Finally, to really push the machines, we also tested the opening of this monster assembly, the Canada-France-Hawaii telescope, which features over 22,000 bodies. This took our new 7000 series laptop 3 minutes and 35 seconds to open, and our older 3630 desktop took 5 minutes and 20 seconds. This large dataset also allowed our Precision 3660 desktop to really stretch its legs, and it took just 3 minutes to open. So by looking at the open and rebuild results, we can see that the new CPUs are roughly 30 to 40% faster, which will make a pretty significant difference to everyday SolidWorks use. Though so far, we've largely been testing single-threaded or single-core performance. Tasks like simulations make use of multiple cores, so for a multi-threaded performance comparison, let's take a look now at some simulation benchmarks. So to be clear here, the benefit of newer hardware will vary depending on the type of simulation study, the complexity, and the solver. And our first test was a relatively simple structural simulation. This took our new laptop 3 minutes and 50 seconds to complete, roughly 33% faster than the old desktop, which took 5 minutes and 45 seconds. Unsurprisingly, the new desktop performed best here too. Our second test was a CFD study using SolidWorks Flow Simulation. This is one of the workflows which we know sees the most benefits from more cores. So to really put the machines to work, we went for a complex airflow study of a mask with close to 750,000 fluid cells, and we used the adaptive mesh function to further fine-tune the study as well. Our new laptop with its 16-core CPU completed this study in 48 minutes. The four-year-old desktop workstation, however, took nearly twice as long at 1 hour and 30 minutes. The extra power in the new desktop helped it to outperform the laptop here too, taking just 36 minutes for the same task. Hopefully those results give you an idea of how much the CPU matters, and for our recommendation, if you're looking to get the best performance in every aspect of SolidWorks, know that it's best to pick a CPU with a fast turbo speed that has a balance between the number of cores and the speed of those cores. The good news is that currently you don't need to choose between optimal single and multi-core performance, as our testing found that the precision systems with Intel's 12th gen CPUs performed best for both CAD and simulation tasks. Next up, let's take a look at RAM and storage. Now, these are important components, but they aren't easy to compare in a direct side-by-side contest, so we're just going to share our recommendations for these instead. For storage, our advice is simple. Just make sure to pick a solid-state drive, and we recommend going for at least 512GB of M.2 SSD storage. If you're using simulation and visualization tools, which both generate very large files, it'd be best to choose a hard drive with at least 1TB of storage, and always try to ensure that you leave at least 20% free space on your drive to allow it to run optimally. RAM is also straightforward to recommend. The key thing to remember is that you need enough RAM to deal with your most complex workflows, but beyond that point, adding more RAM won't improve performance. If you want to work out how much you need, then try one of your typical workflows and take a look at your memory usage in a tool like Task Manager to see how much you're actually using. Generally, we recommend going for at least 32GB of RAM. And if you're dealing with complex datasets or do a lot of multitasking, you may want to go for 64GB. It's rare to ever need more than that though. So lastly, we've got graphics cards. And graphics cards make a huge difference to the responsiveness of the software, and they influence the speed of rotations, zooms, and pans of your models. Let's take a look at some test results here to explore exactly how much of a difference a new card can make. So first, we use an automated test for graphics performance, which rapidly spins the model and reports back the frame rate. And to really put the machines to the test, we ran this with all visual effects active too. This test might look a little bit strange, but ultimately it gives us a good idea of how smooth each card will be to use. And to stress our graphics cards, we ran this test using the complex telescope dataset from before. The new laptop managed over 30 FPS or frames per second for this test, whereas the older desktop dropped to about 20 FPS, which is just about usable, but far from ideal. We also tested some other graphics cards from the current range, and we found that the Nvidia RTX A4500 graphics card for laptops managed a smooth 40 FPS, and for desktop workstations, the Nvidia RTX A4000 sustained 42 FPS. These are some really impressive results considering the size and the complexity of the dataset we were testing with. The takeaway here is that for core CAD work, you will get the most benefit from the higher end Nvidia professional graphics cards when dealing with complex datasets. They continue to deliver extremely responsive graphics even as the complexity rises, but ultimately don't forget about optimizing your assembly and running appropriate settings for the best experience too. The final set of tests we ran were for comparing render times using SolidWorks Visualize, and this is probably where we saw the biggest leap in performance. This scene of the Nemo submarine underwater uses advanced volumetric lighting effects to show how the headlights cut through the undersea gloom. Lighting like this is complex to render, which makes it a perfect test. The new laptop with the Nvidia RTX A3000 rendered this scene in 4K in just 3 minutes and 8 seconds. This was almost 3 times quicker than the 4-year-old desktop, which features an Nvidia Quadro P4000, which was an impressive card in its day. That took 8 minutes and 52 seconds to complete the same render. The top of the range new Nvidia cards for desktops upped performance even further, taking just 1 minute 33 seconds to render this same scene. And if that's not fast enough, anyone needing ultimate performance could actually fit 2 of these cards into some new machines, such as the Precision 7865. And the benefit here is pretty simple, as adding a second card will pretty much cut your render time in half. This is probably unnecessary for single frame renders like this one, but for anyone that's creating rendered animations, this could give you a serious speed increase. And with render times covered, that brings us to the end of our test results. Hopefully you now have a good idea of how much a new machine will benefit you. If you're thinking you do want to upgrade, then why not check out our range of pre-configured workstations on our website? These have been configured for different use cases, and they have performance ratings for the key SolidWorks workflows to help you understand easily what each machine is best suited for. If you're still unsure or you'd like something bespoke, we're always happy to provide advice, so please get in touch. Thanks for watching.